we are looking at analysis of convergence or convergence analysis of these methods. So Ax equal to b is a set of linear algebraic equations, and what we have looked at till now is forming, you know, iteration scheme. So iteration scheme was formed as by splitting this matrix as S minus T, okay, and then you come up with a iteration scheme by rearranging this equation, that is S minus T into x equal to b. This you rearrange, and in vector form, for the purpose of analysis, we can rewrite this equation as x . So my iteration scheme in general is xk plus 1 is equal to S inverse T xk and plus S inverse B. So this is the way we have written this for the purpose of analysis. Different choices of S and T will give you Jacobi method, Gauss-Seidel method, and relaxation method, and so on. And when you actually reach the solution, what you get is x star is equal to S inverse T, S inverse B. So this is let's say this is the solution, okay, of the system of equation Ax equal to B. If I subtract, okay, then I get this equation. Okay, so we have been looking at this general equation you know, error or distance from the true solution is equal to S inverse T into Ek, where k here is the index of iteration. Okay, so I start my iterations from some arbitrary x naught. This is my iteration equation. X naught will give me x1 will give me x2 if you substitute in this. Okay, we will get a sequence of vectors x1 x2 x3 x4 starting from x naught. The question is, under what conditions will this sequence converge to the true solution? Under what condition this error will go to zero? Okay, that's what we are looking at. So we abstracted this by a general linear difference equation. We said that this exactly looks like zk plus 1 is equal to b zk. Okay, and in my last lecture, what I have done is derived conditions under which this particular equation will actually behave as we want, that is zk will go to 0 as k goes to infinity, as k increases. Okay, so I have derived general conditions for this linear difference equation. We just mapped this specific equation that we are looking at to this general equation, and then we derived certain conditions. So these conditions are as follows. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to define this spectral radius of a matrix. So spectral radius of matrix B is defined as So here lambda I represents eigenvalue, ith eigenvalue of matrix B. Okay, I'm looking at mod of that, magnitude of this ith eigenvalue, okay, and maximum over that. So spectral radius of a matrix is defined as maximum over I eigenvalues 1 to n, whatever eigenvalues that we have, and this is over eigenvalue, maximum magnitude eigenvalue is called as the spectral radius of matrix B. So the condition that we derived was something like this, that if A is spectral radius of B is strictly less than 1, the spectral radius of A is strictly less than 1, then what we have shown is that ZK will go to 0, norm of ZK will go to 0 as K goes to infinity. As K increases, what I mean by K goes to infinity, as K increases, okay, norm of ZK goes to 0 if all the eigenvalues of B are strictly inside the unit circle, if all the eigenvalues are strictly inside unit circle. Okay. The second condition that we derived was something like this, okay, that instead of strictly less than 1, if some eigenvalues are on the unit circle, okay, then what happens is that norm of ZK will not go to 0. What will happen in that case is that norm of ZK will remain bounded. Okay, so in this particular case, norm of ZK as K goes to infinity. Okay, and the third condition that we derived. So what is important here is that without actually having to solve, just looking at eigenvalues or the spectral radius of matrix B, we can tell how the asymptotic solution is going to behave. Okay, we don't have to actually solve it for a specific Z naught and say how the solution will behave. We just look at the eigenvalues and we can tell how the solution will behave. So the last case was if norm ZK was if spectral radius of spectral radius of B, if this is strictly less than or equal to 1, the spectral radius of G is strictly less than or equal to 1, then norm ZK is bounded, okay, as K goes to infinity. Okay, so spectral radius will directly tell you whether the solution is asymptotically bounded or asymptotically converging to 0. Okay, and the last condition was the spectral radius of B is greater than 1. So if one of the eigenvalues is outside the unit circle, okay, then norm ZK tends to infinity as okay. So spectral radius of B is what critically decides how the asymptotic behavior of the solution is going to be. Okay. If spectral radius is strictly inside the unit circle, okay, then norm of ZK will go to 0 as K goes to infinity. If the spectral radius, okay, is less than or equal to 0, which means some of the if some of the eigenvalues are on the unit circle, okay, in some matrices, in such cases the error will remain bounded. Actually, strictly speaking, we should say it is strictly less than 0. We can even replace this condition by equal to 1. We can replace this condition by spectral radius equal to 1, and the third case as spectral radius greater than 1. So if this will happen if one or more eigenvalues are on the unit circle, okay, the first condition will occur if all the eigenvalues are inside the unit circle, and this condition if any one of the eigenvalues is outside the unit circle. Then so what is the implication when it comes to solving linear algebraic equations iteratively? Okay, this is our iteration scheme. Okay, and this is the error or distance from the true solution. Okay, the question is, will the distance from the true solution shrink? Okay, will you go towards the true solution as k goes to infinity, as or k increases, as iteration index increases, will you approach x star? Okay, now that will depend upon spectral radius of S inverse T. Okay, that will depend upon spectral radius of S inverse T. If you just apply these conditions, okay, what we would want is the first condition, that is spectral radius of S inverse T should be strictly less than 1. Okay, spectral radius of this should be strictly less than 1 in order that the iterations converge to the true solution. What is important here is, if spectral radius is, if I choose this SNT matrices in such a way that this condition on the spectral radius is satisfied, then convergence will occur for any initial guess that you give here. Okay. See, we are going to use iterative methods for solving Ax equal to b when A is a large matrix. Okay. It's a very large matrix. And how do you give initial guess? Okay, it's very difficult. So because I do not know the solution, so how do I start? How do I kick start? So what this tells you is that if eigenvalues of S inverse T are inside unit circle, okay, then I am guaranteed to converge to the solution from whatever initial guess you give. Okay, so you can give an arbitrary guess, you are guaranteed to converge, provided spectral radius of S inverse T is less than 1, is strictly less than 1. Okay. So the condition that we get from this analysis for convergence of iterative schemes is that spectral radius of S inverse T should be strictly less than 1. So this is the condition that is important. Okay, this is the convergence criteria. So if I choose S inverse T in such a way that, okay, now these kind of equations, okay, I just want to touch upon something else before I move to a little bit of digression from what we have been doing. This kind of equations do appear in other context when we are doing numerical analysis. I just want to point to that before I move to something more related to this convergence analysis. Okay, in this particular case, we are getting these equations in the context of iterative schemes. Okay, where k here is the index of iteration. Okay, and starting from some initial guess, we are getting a new guess, and so on. Okay, and we are looking at the convergence of iterations. Okay, in some other context, we get very very similar equations, except the k there will not be iteration index; it could be time. Okay, see, for example, let us look at this equation dx by dt is equal to ax, okay, where initial condition x naught, okay, here a is a n cross n matrix, x is a vector. Okay, x belongs to Rn, and I want to solve this kind of an equation, okay, using say simply Euler method. Okay, so Euler method, if I apply to this particular equation, forward difference method, then I will get x t plus h minus x t divided by h will be equal to a x at t. Okay, so this equation I can rearrange and write at x T plus H is equal to I plus H times A XT. Okay, and let us start now writing this solution starting from time 0. Okay, so initial condition is x0. Initial condition is x0. Okay, so at t equal to h, we will get x2h is equal to I plus ha into x. Well, we will start at 0. So at x equal to h, at t equal to h, at t equal to 0, let's start from t equal to 0. Let's start from t equal to 0. So this will be xh, xh equal to x0. Okay, then x2h is equal to I plus ha into xh. Okay, then x3h is equal to I plus ha into x2h. Okay, you can just go on writing the solution of this difference equation. Okay, and then finally what you can show is that this is xk plus 1 times h is equal to I plus ha. In general, at kth instant in time, I can write this equation, difference equation. Now, this difference equation is qualitatively similar to this equation. It's qualitatively similar to this equation, except when we looked at this equation, this k was considered to be index of iteration. Okay, I could replace this, I could reinterpret this as time. Okay, this is the same equation, xk plus 1 is equal to some matrix into xk. Okay, and if I want to analyze behavior of this numerical iteration scheme, I could look at spectral radius of this matrix. Okay, so this is a very fundamental equation, and this appears in many different contexts. Okay, for example, I would want to decide how to choose. Let's say original system is asymptotically stable. Okay, that means all the eigenvalues of matrix A are in the left half plane. Okay, and the solutions of that particular system asymptotically go to 0. Question is, will the numerical solution behave in the same way? How do I choose this integration interval H so that the solution, approximate solution constructed by Newton's by Euler method is same as the analytical solution? This question will be revisiting later in the course, but I'm just preempting that a very, very similar equation will arise at that point. So this particular matrix, you can look at spectral radius of this matrix and comment upon whether this solution is going to go to 0 or whether solution is going to go and explode. So this particular analysis is very, very generic. Okay, let's come back to our original case. Okay, so as I said, we have been looking at this iterative schemes, that is x k plus 1 is equal to s inverse t xk plus s inverse b. Okay, this is for solving ax equal to b, and we have written a matrix as s minus t. Okay, and we have been looking at, or we have been analyzing ek plus 1 is equal to s inverse t. We have been analyzing this equation. Okay, now this is nice that we got a condition which, without having to solve this equation, we can comment upon how the error is going to behave, or how the distance from the true solution is going to behave as a function of iteration index k. Okay, just looking at spectral radius, just looking at eigenvalues of S inverse T. Okay, but then is this something very easy to calculate? The trouble here, this is nice in the sense that it's a nice analytical tool. We got an insight that looking at eigenvalues, you will actually you can actually without actually having solving without actually solving the set of equations, we can comment upon the behavior. But the difficulty now is that I have to compute eigenvalues of this matrix. Okay, just remember that this A matrix could be a large matrix. Okay, for a large matrix, okay, to compute S inverse T and its eigenvalues is even more complex problem. Okay, if I have computational resources to solve this, okay, I might as well solve this by some other numerical method rather than by some other method like, you know, usual technique like Gaussian elimination, rather than wasting my time in computing eigenvalues to see whether the conditions are met or not. Okay, so this is nice. This gives us a lot of insight, but we need something more than or some simpler conditions than this, and this is where we are going to use induced matrix norms. Okay, so using matrix norms, we are going to or using relationship between the spectral radius and the matrix norm, we are going to derive some simpler conditions. If those conditions are satisfied, then we are guaranteed that the iteration method will converge. Okay, so in order that we come up with this simpler conditions, I need to introduce the concept of induced matrix norms. Okay, well, we have been looking at vector spaces, and then I had mentioned that set of matrices, you know, if I have this matrices A, which are n cross m matrices. Okay, this n cross m matrices, set of n cross m matrices, it forms a vector space. These are all real valued matrices. Okay, it forms a vector space, and I can define a norm on this vector space. So I can have a norm vector space or a norm associated with a vector space set of all matrices. Why this is a vector space? This is a vector space because, you know, if I add two matrices, I will get another matrix. If I add two real matrices, a scalar multiplication of any matrix will give me another matrix in the same set. So this is a vector space, and now I need to define a norm on this. So there are various ways of defining norm on this particular space. I am interested in a particular set of norms which are called as induced matrix norms. Okay, so we are going to define this we are going to look at induced matrix norms for matrices which are n cross m. Okay, so this matrix norm, okay, we'll denote this matrix norm by this symbol, norm of matrix A, okay, is actually a map from R n cross m, okay, to R plus. Okay, it's a map from this set of vectors, which is this R n cross m space to R plus. R plus is set of all positive real numbers. The set of all positive real numbers. Okay, because norm has to be positive value. Okay, so this is set of all positive real numbers. Okay, and the definition of an induced matrix norm is as follows. An induced matrix norm is defined as max over x not equal to 0 vector, okay, norm of it is defined as maximum of this particular ratio ax, norm of ax divided by norm of x. Okay, in some sense you can look at this as gain, okay, or amplification power of a matrix. Okay, see, if I decide to write this AX is equal to Y, okay, this is like this Y is a vector, okay, which is obtained when operator A transforms X. Okay, see, actually when a matrix operates on X, it could do various things. For example, it could rotate the vector. Okay, this new vector, it could be a rotated vector. If A is an invertible matrix, in general this will be a rotated vector. It could be a stretched vector, it could be a contracted vector, it could be a, you know, it could be in a reverse direction, it could be reflection. You could actually have A matrix doing a variety of things. It could be a projection. Okay, so this A matrix is like an operator which operates on X, gives you Y. Okay, so in, let's say, control system terminology, this is like, you know, this is input, this is output. Okay, and then we could ask this question that, you know, what is norm of AX divided by norm of X? We could look at this particular quantity, norm of AX. Okay, I'm interested in finding a maximum value. Okay, I'm interested in finding a maximum value, okay, which bounds this ratio. Okay, this maximum value, okay, this maximum value which bounds this ratio is called as the norm. Of course, I want it in such a way that for some x, this ratio is attained. Okay, which means I don't want a bound which is not reachable. So for some value of x, equality holds. For remaining values, inequality holds. So I want to find out that number. Okay, so this norm of A is nothing but a ratio, is nothing but a bound on this ratio. Okay, so you could view this as, you know, amplification factor of a matrix or amplification power of a matrix. Okay. Now, why it is an induced norm? What is it? What is special about it being an induced norm? Okay. This norm is induced by, see, this is my domain and this is the range. Okay. This is my domain and this is the range. Okay. I have defined a norm on the range. I have defined a norm on the domain. The definition of norm on the range and definition of norm on the domain together will define an induced norm. So these two induce a norm which is this A. So for example, I could define a 1-2 norm . Okay, see, this AX is an element in a range space. There could be a different norm associated in that range space. Okay, I might be using one norm in the range space. Okay, I have another norm defined in the domain, that is 2 norm. Okay, so I could define a norm which is induced norm, which is induced by the norms defined on the domain and the range space, and I could call this as A12. Okay, this is one norm and this is 2 norm. Now, this kind of funny definitions of norms are rarely used in practice. Okay, we don't do this. Okay, normally what we are interested in. So I'm just telling you that this is possible. This is not what is actually used. Okay, what we normally do is that we use one norm or 2 norm. For example, if I define 2 norm, then this is 2 norm by 2 norm. Okay, then it would be called 2 norm of a matrix A. Similarly, I could define one norm which is max x not equal to 0 norm AX. So this is one norm divided by one norm. Okay, I want to find out ratio, maximum of this ratio. Okay. So, in particular, we are going to use three different norms in this course. One is two norm, other one is one norm, and a third one is infinite norm. So, the infinite norm will be simply defined as infinite norm here and infinite norm here. Okay. So, I am interested in one norm, two norm, and infinite norm. And these norms will help us, the relationship between the norm and the spectral radius will help us decide the behavior of solutions, asymptotic behavior of solutions. Okay. So it's so far so good, we have defined this norm. The question is, how do I compute a norm? Okay. If I can compute a norm very easily, okay, then it makes sense to use norm instead of spectral radius as a measure of convergence of iterative schemes. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is initially, okay, I'm going to find a way of computing two norm. Okay. Well, that is more for the reason of let's say pedagogic reason that give you some insights into how the norm is computed. Okay. Again, but the problem is going to be with two norm is that we will get again eigenvalues. So again, to compute two norm, you have to compute eigenvalues. Okay. So it's not again convenient. Okay. And finally, we will move on to definitions of one norm and infinite norm, which will be used subsequently in the analysis. Okay. Nevertheless, okay, from the viewpoint of getting insight, I am going to first look at two norm. Okay. So what I want to do is to compute numerically this value for two norm of a vector. Okay, I want to numerically compute value for this two norm of a vector. Okay, what I'm going to do now is square this equation on both the sides. Okay, I'm going to square this equation on both the sides. So 2 norm square is equal to 2 norm square is equal to 2 norm square. Okay, is equal to 2 norm square. So this is AX. What is 2 norm of a vector? See, this AX is a vector. Okay, AX is a vector. Okay, 2 norm of that is given by, or square of 2 norm is given by AX transpose AX, okay, divided by X transpose X. Okay, I want to find out this ratio, okay, which actually translates to finding out X transpose A transpose A X divided by X transpose X. Okay, I want to find out this ratio X transpose. Okay, so before we move to actually calculating the two norm, let me state few properties of norm. See, when you call a function to be a norm, what are the conditions that it should meet? Well, the first condition is that So we need to examine whether these ratios, do they qualify to be called as norms? Okay. So the first condition or the first axiom that a norm function should satisfy is that norm of A should be greater than 0 if A is not equal to the null matrix, is not equal to the null, to the 0 vector. 0 vector in the set of matrices is null matrix. Okay, so this should be greater than 0 if the matrix is not equal to 0, and this A should be equal to 0 if A is equal to null matrix. So this is the first condition that it should satisfy. Okay, the second condition that this function should satisfy is norm of alpha. Some alpha is some arbitrary scalar from the scalar field that is under consideration, should be equal to mod alpha norm A. It's very easy to check these conditions are satisfied by the given definition. Okay. The third condition is the triangle inequality. Okay. The third condition is A plus B, norm of A plus B. If you take any two matrices A and B from this space or set of matrices, n cross m matrices, then what you can show is that norm A plus norm B, okay, norm of A plus B is less than or equal to norm A plus norm B. This is the triangular inequality. Starting from the definition, it's very, very easy to show all these three axioms hold. So this given definitions, actually the given definition of induced norm actually satisfies all the three properties, and it's indeed a norm. And then there is one more property which is followed by all the matrix norms, which is additional, which is not part of the axioms, is that if I have multiplication of two matrices AB, okay, then this is always equal to norm A norm B, okay. This is always less than or equal to norm A plus norm B. This particularly would be useful for square matrices, okay. Any arbitrary m cross n matrix you cannot probably okay. So before I actually do computations for two norm, okay, I want to give you a little bit of reinterpretation of definition of norm, okay. So we said that this AX, okay, this ratio AX by X is bounded by norm of A, okay. Now this norm of X is a positive scalar. This X is not equal to 0, so norm of X is a positive scalar, and I can always rewrite this as A times X by norm X less than or equal to A. What is this? This is nothing but, if I call this as X cap, this is a unit vector such that this one is nothing but a unit vector. So for any arbitrary vector X, okay, X upon norm X is nothing but a unit vector. So this will be X hat. So norm of X hat, yeah, norm of X hat will be equal to 1. Yeah, yeah, thanks for the correction. So norm of X hat, X upon norm X, will always be equal to 1. Okay, and then I could redefine the norm as, I could redefine norm of matrix A as set of, you know, max over, okay, I could redefine my norm as max over X hat is equal to 1, okay. And of course this is for the set where this will happen only when X is not equal to 0. So that is implicit here, okay. We are excluding the point origin, that is implicit here. So I could redefine my norm as X hat is equal to 1, okay, norm A X hat, where X hat is a unit vector, okay. So if I take this, let's say in two dimensions, if I take this unit circle in X1, X2, okay, so this is X1, X2, okay, all the vectors can map onto this unit vector, okay, because you can normalize them by X by norm of X, okay. And then we are looking for, and this is very easy to interpret, we are looking for that value of ratio, okay, which is maximum when you move along this circle, okay. When you move along this circle, what is the point where you get the maximum of this norm X by norm AX by X, or maximum of the ratio when A X cap, or maximum of this norm A X cap, okay, in the range space. So this could be another way of interpreting the induced matrix norm, okay. Okay, let's now move on to computing the two norm. So for computing two norm, what I had said was norm AX 2 square. So I wrote this as AX transpose AX by X transpose X, which is same as X transpose A transpose A X by X transpose X. Okay. Now the question is, how do I find maximum of this ratio? Okay. How do I find maximum of this ratio? What I'm going to do now is do some algebraic tricks and then find a maximum of this ratio. I'm going to first of all observe this matrix. This matrix is always a symmetric matrix. Transpose of this matrix is itself a symmetric matrix. Okay. If A is a full rank matrix, A transpose A, okay, A transpose A, you know, what will be A transpose A? Will it be always positive definite or positive semi-definite? Depends upon what are dimensions of M and N, okay. Depending upon dimensions of M and N, A transpose A is always a positive definite matrix or it's a positive semi-definite matrix. Okay, so this is a symmetric matrix and it's always a positive semi-definite matrix. Okay, so A transpose A is symmetric is symmetric and positive semi-definite. Why it is positive semi-definite? How do you define positive definiteness? X transpose suppose this you call this matrix B, okay, X transpose BX should be greater than or equal to 0. Okay, look here. Okay, this is a vector, okay, into you know, this vector transpose this vector is always going to be positive or is always going to be greater than or equal to 0. Even if X lies in the null space of A, this will be, you know, this numerator can be 0 or it can be positive, it can never be negative. Okay, so that's why this matrix A transpose A will always be a positive definite or a positive semi-definite matrix. Okay, let's take a special case where A transpose A is a positive definite matrix. It's a symmetric matrix. Let's take a special case where it is positive definite matrix. Okay, so it's a positive definite matrix. Okay, for the sake of convenience, okay, let us further assume that A transpose A has linearly independent eigenvectors. Okay, I'm going to make an assumption, additional assumption, that is this required? If it's a positive definite matrix, symmetric positive definite matrix, the eigenvectors are linearly independent. In fact, something more. They are orthogonal, symmetric, then they are orthogonal, or they are ortho, you can also choose them orthonormal. Okay. So it follows actually from this assumption that A has linearly independent A transpose A. Okay, these are linearly independent eigenvectors. Not only that, so in fact the eigenvectors are orthogonal. Okay, so symmetric positive definite matrix, okay, the eigenvectors are linearly independent and they are orthogonal. Okay, that's much stronger property. So I can write this A transpose A, okay, I can write A transpose A okay, I want to split A transpose A as, you know, psi lambda psi inverse. Okay, I want to diagonalize this matrix. Okay, what is this psi matrix? This psi matrix, it consists of eigenvectors of A transpose A. So let's say V1 is eigenvector of A transpose A, V2 is eigenvector of A transpose A. So these are n eigenvectors of A transpose A. Okay. Then I can diagonalize this matrix A transpose A, okay, using eigenvectors and this lambda is a diagonal matrix which consists of lambda 1, okay, this is a diagonal matrix, okay. I can rewrite this as A transpose A is equal to psi lambda psi inverse, okay. In fact, this eigenvectors of A transpose A, they are orthogonal, okay, and it follows that the psi inverse, okay, is nothing but psi transpose. We can show, because of the orthogonality property, that psi inverse is equal to psi transpose, okay, because the eigenvectors are orthogonal. You can choose them to be orthonormal. If you choose them to be orthonormal, then this property will hold, okay, psi inverse equal to psi transpose. And then I can write A transpose A as psi lambda psi transpose, okay. If you just want to see a quick derivation of this, it would be a very quick derivation of this would go something like this. Let's say A transpose A times V1 is equal to lambda 1 V1. This is the first eigenvalue and eigenvector combination of A transpose A. Okay. A transpose A V2 is equal to lambda 2 V2 and so on. I can combine these equations as A transpose A V1, A transpose A V2, all that I have done is I have kept these vectors next to each other. So this matrix is equal to this matrix. I have combined all these equations into one single equation, okay. And then I can write this as A transpose A into V1, V2, Vn is equal to V1 to Vn into lambda 1 okay. I can rearrange this equation. This is my psi matrix, okay, and with this I can simply write, because these are orthogonal vectors and orthonormal, and this is an invertible matrix. I can write, so this is psi, this is psi. So A transpose A is equal to psi lambda psi transpose, or psi lambda psi inverse. Okay, I have chosen eigenvectors to be orthonormal. Okay, and this is my diagonal matrix lambda. Okay, so this derivation is very, very straightforward. Okay, so now having done this, what I'm going to do, I'm going to use this to arrive at the norm of, or two norm of the matrix. So coming back to our two norm definition, we have X transpose A transpose A X by X transpose X. Okay, what I'm going to do here is to replace A transpose A by this term. So this is equal to, so this is 2 norm square is equal to this term. Okay, so this is nothing but X transpose psi lambda psi transpose X divided by X transpose X. Okay, I'm going to define a transformation now, which is, okay, I'm going to define a transformation Z, which is equal to psi transpose X. Using this transformation, I can write x transpose psi lambda psi transpose x, okay, divided by x transpose x. This is equal to z transpose lambda z divided by x transpose x. Okay. Now I want to play one more trick. Okay. I know that psi transpose is equal to I. Okay. Psi transpose is equal to I. Using this identity, or psi transpose psi is equal to I. Okay. Using this identity, I'm going to write this as x transpose psi transpose x is equal to x transpose x, because psi transpose is equal to I. Okay. So this is nothing but z transpose z. This is nothing but z transpose z. Okay. Now with this transformation, my two norm square, this becomes z transpose lambda z divided by z transpose z. Okay. Now this is a diagonal matrix. So this is nothing but lambda 1 z1 square plus lambda 2 z2 square, lambda n zn square, z1 square plus z2 square, zn square. Okay, so I have expressed A transpose A. I have expressed square of A, norm of A, okay, in terms of this ratio of two polynomials. What you can see very easily, that this is, the numerator is always a positive number, because A transpose A is a positive definite matrix. All eigenvalues of A transpose A are positive. So this is always a positive number divided by this, which is a positive number. Okay. Now let's order the eigenvalues. Like, let's number the eigenvalues. We can number the eigenvalues the way we want. I am ordering them in such a way, I'm numbering them in such a way that lambda 1 is the largest magnitude eigenvalue. Okay, lambda 1 is the largest magnitude eigenvalue. Okay, what you can show is here lambda 1 is the largest magnitude eigenvalue. Okay, so I can replace lambda 2 by lambda 1, lambda 3 by lambda 1, lambda 4 by lambda 1. Okay, what I can show is that this ratio here, if I is always less than or equal to, okay, lambda 1 square z1 square plus lambda 1 square z2 square, there will be
no square.
Oh yeah, sorry. Yeah, thanks for correction. So lambda 1 into lambda 1 up into z1 square plus lambda 2. What I have done is in this particular case, I have just replaced lambda 2 by lambda 1, lambda 3 by lambda 1. Okay. So this inequality will always hold. This is equal to lambda 1. Okay. So lambda 1 is an upper bound on this ratio. Okay. So what we have effectively shown is that, if I just move here, what we have effectively shown is that norm A2 square is equal to, x transpose AX by x transpose x. This is equal to z transpose lambda z by z transpose z, which is less than or equal to lambda 1. This is the largest magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A. Okay, so this is where z is equal to psi transpose X. Psi consists of orthonormal eigenvectors of A transpose A. So this here is largest magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A, or the largest singular value of A, in other words. Okay. So what it turns out is that if I come back here, it turns out that for a particular value or for a particular value of Z, the bound is attained. Okay. So we can actually show equality. We can actually show equality, and then further we can show that norm A to norm of A is nothing but square root of what we have proved effectively is that 2 norm of A is nothing but maximum magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A. A transpose A is positive definite. Okay, even if it is semi-definite, this equality will hold. I have just done everything for a simpler case. Okay. So this is what we have proved, that 2 norm of a matrix can be computed as maximum magnitude eigenvalue, square root of the maximum magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A. Okay, or square root of the maximum magnitude singular value of A. Okay, it's also called singular value of A. So, but again there is a problem. Okay, eigenvalue. Okay, so 2 norm, we wanted to compute something which is computationally simple. Okay, for S inverse T, but again we are stuck with eigenvalue. So this is not convenient. We will move on in the next lecture to finding out 1 norm and infinite norm. Okay, so which are more convenient. Nevertheless, this derivation is quite, it gives insight into how the norm can be computed, and that's why for the pedagogic reason, I have done this derivation. But more useful thing is 1 norm and infinite norm, which we'll be discussing in the next lecture.